are talking about the importance of branding with regard to Islam and saying how do we distinguish ourselves as Muslims. Today we'll talk, inshallah, about, we talked about eat halal, we will talk today about earn halal. Islam, as you know and as I know, is not the name for a set of rituals. It is not the name for a method of worship. It is not the name for any small specific thing. Islam is the name of a deen, a complete way of life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent for us through His Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore Islam addresses and provide solutions for every aspect of our life. It's not only restricted to how to worship or something else. It expands and it consists of every aspect of our life. It impacts on our behavior, our akhlaq. It impacts on our mu'ashira, which is our society. It impacts on our mu'amilat, which is our dealings with people, which includes, of course, financial dealings. And of course, Islam addresses aqidah and ibadat. So this is the five areas of life of a person. Now, in terms of dealings, in terms of earning, the basic principle in the Sharia is, as we know, that everything is halal except that which has been prohibited. And among the things which have been prohibited, obviously we know some of the major ones, which is to deal in anything which is itself haram. So naturally dealing in drugs and alcohol and pork and so forth. But one of the most important ones is the issue of interest, the issue of riba. And this is where a lot of people get dragged into areas where they are essentially consuming haram. A very important matter in this is to understand the issue of risk. Understand what is risk. Understand how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has distributed risk. Understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Raziq. And as I told you, there is a series of lectures of mine, about four lectures, which deal with this whole topic in complete detail. So listen to them, watch them. But in brief, a very good foundation for our own understanding is to take the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said that 1 dirham of haram in 100 dirham of halal makes the whole thing haram. And that is a good principle to use. You cannot go wrong with that. If you move away from this, then you go into some very shady areas, where some people have ruled that a certain percentage of haram income is permissible if the majority of the income is halal. And these percentages vary depending on which fatwa you are reading. Somebody says 10%, somebody says 15%, somebody says 35%, and various percentages, Allah knows best. But my point is very simple. My point is that when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that one out of 100 is how many percent? 1%. So if we said that 1% makes everything haram, then why do we need to go and search for anything else? The problem which happens is, and this is something which is really for the muftiin and for the fuqaha to seriously reflect on, is that when you start creating suhulat, when you start creating convenience, with the best of intentions, it is the purpose of the job of a faqih, the job of a mufti, is to make the life of a person easy, not to make it difficult. So the intention of the mufti is, we are not questioning the intention. We are not saying that the mufti is corrupt or something, nauzubillah. We are saying that with the best of intentions, in certain matters, if you permit certain things, and if you make certain things easy, then a clean system will never be established. We'll never waste time. And that, and the very reason why, if you just think about this, the ayat prohibiting riba, the ayat not only making it haram, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah and His Nabi declare war on the one who deals with riba. There is nothing in the Quran, not zina, not pork, not liquor, not gambling, not anything, which has been prohibited with such severity as has been prohibited riba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared war, harb, on only two things. One declared war on the one dealing with riba, and the other one, Allah declared war on the one who causes harm to His awliya. So when something has been prohibited with such severity, the ayat were revealed not yesterday, not 10 years ago, not 100 years ago, not 200 years ago. The ayat were revealed in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you ask yourself that why is it that 1400 years later, we still do not have a viable, global, robust Islamic banking system. Please understand my words. I'm not saying that there is no Islamic banking at all. There is Islamic banking, there is a bank here, there is a bank there, and so on and so forth. But do we have a robust, global Islamic banking system? Does Islamic banking control the finances of the world? And the answer is no. And that is not because Muslims don't have money. Muslims have money. Muslims have a lot of money. Why do you think banks like the do you know which is the largest Islamic bank in the world? HSBC. HSBC is the biggest Islamic bank in the world. What does that mean? Because HSBC, as you know, is a regular haram bank. It's a regular bank dealing in riba. So how is it an Islamic bank? They have an Islamic banking branch. What do? They take the funds of the Muslims and they invest them in Islamically Sharia compliant stocks and so on and so forth, and they give them a return. Just one banking instrument which deals with people who have large amounts of money who are looking for a halal return. That's all. Why are they doing that? Because they make a lot of money in the process. You don't want interest, that is brilliant. As far as I'm concerned, if I can take your money and I don't even have to pay you interest, then I love you. I love your money. Right? Why does this, why do we have this situation? Because we have not been strict. I seriously believe that with regard to interest-based banking, it is essential for the fuqaha to be completely and totally rigid. Totally rigid. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared war on, how do you give a convenience there? On what basis? If you become completely rigid, then people will be forced to create a system which is actually halal. Until that rigidity comes, the system will not happen. Believe me. Second big issue is that the fuqaha who are on the boards of the Islamic banks, the Sharia boards of Islamic banks, to have a faqih, to have a mufti on a Sharia board of an Islamic bank is like having a judge in the court who is paid by the two people who are fighting the case. The plaintiff and the dependent and the defendant, if they are paying the salary of the judge, what do you say about the possibility of justice in that court? The point I'm making is, I'm not saying the judge is therefore corrupt. No. All I'm saying is there's a principle in the Sharia that not only must you be correct, but you must also be visible, you must appear to be correct. For example, if you find that an alim who looks like an alim, right, is coming out of a disco or coming out of a bar, right? So you ask the Sheikh, what happened to him? How come you are coming out of this bar? He said, no, I went there to give dawah to the people. Right? He said, la hawla wa quwwata, I mean, you have to find another place to give dawah. This is not proper for you. We are not saying that you are drinking alcohol But you are not, why are you coming out of this bar? I mean, you know, this is not, this is not correct. This is not, your vakar does not, does not permit you that you should come out of, even if you're going, so even to go and give dawah, you say the place to give dawah is not the bar, right? You give the dawah somewhere else to these people. I mean, don't go inside that place. That is the issue. The issue is not that the, Na'udhubillah, I mean, alhamdulillah, we've got the names that we know of people who are sitting on the Sharia boards are extremely good people. We have complete faith and trust in them as individuals. But I'm saying that is equal to coming out of a bar. I know you will not drink, but you are in the wrong place, man. So if you are on the Sharia board of a bank, and the bank is paying your salary, then this is wrong. The appearance of it is wrong. And that's exactly what is happening today in the Islamic banking world and the world of Sharia boards. This is also equally true which is happening with regard to halal certification organizations. The other day we spoke about that. Halal certification of organizations, how do they, where does their income come from? From the companies who are manufacturing those products. So I'm manufacturing a product, I'm paying you a fee to stamp my product halal. Now how do I, as an outsider, as a consumer, how do I trust that? Tell me. Essentially, who must pay the salaries of the muftis on the Sharia boards? Public. We should pay. We should pay. Because it is in our interest. Who should pay the halal certifying organizations? We should pay. Or if it's an Islamic state, the state should pay. Not the banks and not the manufacturing companies. The judge, who is the mufti on the bank? He is like the judge in the court. The judge in the court must have an income which is independent of the two people who are fighting the case. The judge must be above board. As far as judge is concerned, the judge must not have anything to gain or lose, whichever way he decides the case. Only then we can say that this is a justice will be done, inshallah. So very, very clear, what I would like to say is, obviously you have no control over who sits on which board, so forget that. But certainly you have control over what you earn. So do go and take expert opinions on that, but ensure that every single cent of your earning is halal. If you are not doing that, and if you have got haram mixed with that, no matter how little it is, as I said yesterday in my talk, that is like having a certain percentage of urine in a glass of water that you are drinking. So you decide how much urine you want to drink in that glass of water. Is 10% okay, or 15% okay, or 35% okay, or maybe you want, like Moraji Desai, to drink only urine without any water, Allahu Alam. Right? Do think about this. I'm saying seriously, I know it is disgusting. I hope you are disgusted. Because that's what eating haram is, 1,000 times worse than this. Because eating haram will take you into Jahannam. Right? Straight. Without any, it's like a grease slide. You know, you put your foot on it and come, zoom. So let us be very clear. Let us eat halal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla wa ala is not muhtaj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not dependent on you earning some haram from somewhere because he cannot feed you. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can and will feed us halal. The test is on us. The test is for us. If you say, I will not eat any haram, wallahi Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you halal from sources that you cannot even imagine. But if you also make all these, you know, conveniences, and then you come and say, well, you know, I have a fatwa from this jamia or that mufti, as I said yesterday, there is a difference between a hukum and a fatwa. Law and legal opinion. Two different things. A mufti can give you a fatwa, and that does not mean the mufti is dishonest. No, he is giving you a fatwa based on his understanding. But does that change the hukum? It does not. The hukum is the hukum. Khalas. Now, if I am a lawyer and you come to me you ask me for a legal opinion in a particular matter, maybe it's a matter of tax or something, and I give you an opinion, I say, this is my understanding. Now, my understanding may be wrong. So now, when the police comes for you or the taxman comes for you, and you say, no, I've got this legal opinion, which in Arabic is fatwa. This is the fatwa of so-and-so about this tax. So therefore, I am not liable to pay the tax. He says, sorry, what's, you know, you're the guy you asked the legal opinion from, he was wrong. So that piece of paper that you have got has no value, has no meaning. Throw it away. As far as we are concerned, you are guilty. It is your job to find out whether you are breaking the law or not. Now you can say, well, you know, I went to the Mufti and you went to the Mufti, you did not go to the Mufti, is immaterial. If you broke the law, you broke the law. So do not fall into this trap. By all means, that's why I said, the best, that's why the hadith on Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and obviously this applies, doesn't apply to everybody, it applies to people who have some taqwa in the heart, where he said the best Mufti is your own heart. Ask your own heart. But obviously if your heart is already corrupted, it's not going to tell you the right answer. So the heart has to have some taqwa in this. But inshallah, the people listening here, we assume that the hearts are good, inshallah. So make very, very sure, as I told you, you know, I gave you a disgusting example. Keep that example in mind. Getting a fatwa does not solve your problem. Like Maulana said yesterday in his talk, you may have a fatwa, but the responsibility is still yours. So make sure that we eat halal. Because if we do not eat halal, meaning that if the earning is not halal, then we are in serious problems. One of the questions on the day of judgment is, where did you earn from and where did you spend it? Did you earn halal and spend halal, or did you earn haram and spend haram, or vice versa, whichever it is? Very important questions for us to be able to answer. So let us make sure that we don't fall into that trap. Let us make sure that our earning is 100% halal. And as I told you, Allah does not need your help to feed you. Allah will feed you. So make sure that you eat only, you earn only halal. No contamination, no mixtures, no nothing. Eat halal, earn halal. If it is not halal, shut the shop. Close the business. And Allah will provide you from sources that you cannot imagine. Right? And I'll tell you the example of a Hindu man, not even a Muslim man. Narayana Murthy, the head of Infosys. 100 company worth billions of dollars without a single paisa, a single rupee, a single dollar of interest-based borrowings. Not even one. And not today, from day one. And I spoke to him. I know the guy. I asked him, I said, why didn't you borrow from the banks? Because it's normal for you. He said, because interest destroys wealth. And he says, we decided on day one that we will not borrow on interest. So I said, what did the people say? He said, people said, you will have to shut the company. I said, what did you say? He said, we will shut the company. No problem. We will shut the company, but we will not borrow from the banks. Today, you know Infosys. What is the size of the company? What is the health of the company? Brilliant. And they're following an Islamic system. Even though they are not Muslim, they're not following the Islamic system for the sake of Islam, nothing. Because it just makes good financial sense. I hope the Muslims have this sense. Because not only does it make good financial sense, it also makes good sense with regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's not play games with Allah. Let's not show percentages to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? Let's be very clear and clean. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ نَبِيِّ الْكَرِيمِ وَعَلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا رَحْمَ الرَّحِيمِينَ